grass in that town.
He said, or.
Maybe it won't be bad. Sometimes it always acts that bad. Is it?
You know, get checked and you know how to work quicker than you can if you've been exposed because you got to wait.
You got a good motor, a mechanic on Billy. Billy's pretty good. Yeah, I don't blame you. Did you ever go down to the service station in Ryman?
Down in Ryman's house.
Oh, down to his house.
He don't want to leave that
anymore. Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's what he was telling us tonight. He works at his home.
Does everything out of his home?
Yes.
Okay.
And Jessica's
do what? Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Hey, Dave. You remember me at the channel chamber for me? Little okay, thank you, Dad.
That right there?
Yes.
Is it Larry Hare?
Charles, line six.
That's the process.
I have the code. I have the code. Yes, you're close. Oh, no, we're ready to get started anyway. No rush. No, neither one of us. I'm not even talking to y'all. I was talking about the cookouts.
Did you find out?
Yeah, we got several cookouts coming.
Me and you are bringing the paper plates, right?
We're bringing the paper plates, and they're bringing all the food.
I said that on Facebook, guys. Have a cookout at my house. I got the paper plates. I'll bring the rest.
Yeah. Oh, man. That's pretty good. All right. Well, let's see here. I think they're getting music lined up there. Okay. Yeah. Temperature's cooled off just a little bit, hadn't it?
Yeah, went from 90 to 98.
98 coming pretty
soon. 90 down to 88.
Yeah. It went from 98 to 88. Let's all stand together, Dad. Why don't you come on up for me? I need to see you there. Me is sitting in the sun.
All right. Here's the first one tonight. It's called People Need the Lord.
Yeah.
If you believe that tonight, let's say amen and amen.
Yeah. Amen
and amen. 557. Oh, we got the board up there. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, He's the open door.
On the thing about on television today about how you did this this evening, I was watching it. They did more experiment on that all the time, was that they will soon have a medicine now that will help it out.
Yeah, I saw it yesterday where he was talking about it on the news.
Yeah.
Said within a year's time it'll be out on the,
yeah,
in the drugstores and on the shelf. Yeah. It'll be a prescription, but I'm sure the doctors will prescribe it, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. $250 a pill.
Yeah, you never know what the price is going to be. But
well, it's just, you go by what's currently doing in there, like Shirley was taking one that was well over $150.
Is that right? Well, one of my doctors prescribed that Wegovy, and that's for pre-diabetes. I don't have diabetes, but mine's a little bit high, and it also helps you lose weight. And they said $1,300 a month. I said, I think I'll just try to go without it.
Yeah.
$1,300 a month. I thought, who can afford that?
You know, they cure hepatitis now.
I know. I got a friend of mine. Got
through the VA. This guy was in prison. Got out because his dad was in bad shape and he had hepatitis.
Right.
VA, $1,000 a pill, 90 days. The way I have, that's $90,000. But he don't have hepatitis anymore.
Right.
I said, you got to go back to jail? He said, no. I said, well, that don't sound right.
Right. Yes, sir, Joe.
If your own rule of thumb is if it's advertised on TV, you can't afford it.
Yeah. Well, that's probably true. Yeah. That's probably the truth right there. If it's on TV, it's going to be high.
Medicare won't pay for it.
Yeah.
We found out. I know when I had, back in the mid-90s,
Yes, Randy.
We need to remember Shirley.
Okay.
She's doing all right. She's cold, kind of shivery late, you know, keep you warm and that. She's gone through the fourth treatment. She got one more treatment Friday. That'll right. be the last one.
Right.
So hopefully we're going to get to that, and hopefully it's doing what it's supposed to do.
Unless we're wrong. They
told her before, said each time you go, it's going to last a little bit longer because it keeps working inside her each time she goes for the treatment.
Right.
You know, so hopefully it's going to kill everything that's got to kill.
Yeah.
Not even killing anything good, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, we need that from need to pray for.
Yeah.
Sure, we need to pray for sure.
Amen.
And Lewis and Pauline Taylor, let's not forget them, and Calvin and Judy.
Yes, sir.
Pray for all these. And Ruth White, how's Ruth doing, Joe? About the same?
About the same.
Okay. I know she tunes in every service. Hey, Ruth. She watches all the services. Okay. How about unspokens tonight? All right, unspokens. Well, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Remember all of them. Randy, won't you lead us as we start?
Lord God, and I do thank you, Father, for an opportunity for your house of worship and prayer.
Yes.
I pray, Lord God, tonight as we think of those, Lord, that are home, those that can't make it in, Lord, those that are hurting, those that are sick from COVID and all these other diseases that are going around us now. Lord God, we know that you can take care of all that.
Amen.
Lord, someday you will.
Yes.
I pray, Lord God, that you just might deliver a message through Pastor, Father, that we can use, that we can take home with us, Lord.
Amen.
And carry with us, Father, to give us strength and encouragement through the journey. Father, just use us and encourage and strengthen and bless this church, Father. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I failed to mention Linda, Charles and Linda. Charles said that she was sick. He did a COVID test on her and came back negative, but she's still sick. So he said he may have to take her to the emergency care. So keep Linda in your prayers for Charles. Is there trying to figure out what's going on?
What about Linda White?
She's not feeling.
Linda's been sick, I think, too.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. And Rosalie's still getting over her surgery, her back surgery. Okay. Well, I believe that'll be about all the announcements. We don't really have anything.
Yeah.
Coming up, except for our regular service this Sunday, and hope you have a good July the 4th tomorrow, and don't overdo it, and enjoy it. Thank God for the country. Amen.
Amen.
We live in the best country in all the world, and I wouldn't want to live anywhere else. That's for sure. We'll go ahead and take the offering up then. Men, if y'all want to come to the front, we'll take our midweek Bible study offering up. Thank you, Dad, Jerry.
We'll have to.
Donald, you lead us if you will.
Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for your many blessings. Lord, you've heard all the prayer requests in this presence. You want to be there.
Yes.
Lead God and direct, Lord. Go with us now as we receive this offering. May we be good stewards with it. And use it for your praise, honor, and glory. For us in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you.
I have a prayer request. Karen's got COVID. But she hasn't been home, so y'all are good.
Karen's got it?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
Where's she good?
COVID. But she hasn't been at home.
She was here Sunday.
Yep, she was here Sunday. But she just got it this morning. Like her symptoms just started coming out of her fingers.
Sound like this COVID is making a
comeback.
Come back, yeah.
Yeah.
But she
had
been home,
sir.
We just been around us.
Yeah, thank the Lord.
Well, okay.
I like to have her around me, but not with COVID.
Right. Well, I texted her because she said she was sick. Said she had a sinus infection. Mm. And so I said, you might want to test for COVID. Because she that's what somebody is calling me.
Yeah.
And so she tested and she said, I got it.
Oh, man.
She sounds like she's got a cold.
Where's she at?
She's at a friend's.
Okay. And so the friend's not there. She's kind of house sitting for her.
Right.
And so anyway, so she sounded like she had a cold. Mm-hmm. I mean, sounded like really rough. Whatever. So I said, you might want to test. And she tested.
Okay. We'll keep her in prayer. So, go ahead and Jad, you come. We'll sing Amazing Grace. First and last verse.
Or just, if you got, if you don't have that music, you almost feel like you lost. You know? Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Who am I? Who am I? Go ahead. Let's see if I can get through one. I may never know. why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go for who am I? Yes, to an old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I?
These are the Southern Kings. Anybody else need one? Anybody else got one? Okay. You need one? Dad, I believe Brooklyn needs one there. Just kind of walk around and see if anybody else needs one. That way you can kind of keep up with us, and where we're going to slow down a little bit is the Southern Kings, because they had some godly kings with them. The North had zero. They batted zero when it came to godly kings. But the South, oh, they had six or seven good kings interspersed between their history. And so we want to look at the kings of Judah, the divided kingdom. If you remember, we had a united kingdom. The united kingdom was when you had three different kings ruling over all the earth, or over all of Israel, put it that way. And who were those three kings? David was one of them, Solomon was one of them, and King Saul. Yeah. You had King Saul, you had David, and Solomon, right. Now, when Solomon died, the problem occurred. We had Rehoboam, his son, came into power. And as you see on your handout here, he ruled from 931 to 913 B.C. He died of natural causes. He did evil. He didn't do like his dad did. Solomon, for the most part, was a good king. In the latter part of his life, he let some relationships with different countries throw him off course. But as we look here at the, well, let's see, are we back on Ahab? Okay. Ahab number 3. I mean, number 50. Is that number 51 there, Joe?
Yeah.
Okay.
You want me going down?
Yeah, I can. Yeah, let's put it on. I think we'll go ahead on to the, let's see. I'll take care of it, Joe. Let's look at Ahab just for a moment. He did evil, fatally wounded in battle. His son, King Ahaziah, fell from the palace and never recovered. A death that was foretold by Elijah. What was it that Ahab did that got him into so much trouble? You remember what he did?
Jezebel,
right. Ahab and Jezebel stole some property from a little Jew by the name of Naboth. And they wanted this little vineyard that was beside the kingdom there, beside his throne. And it was right outside the palace doors. And Naboth said, "We can't sell our property. It's in the Bible. Jews have to keep it in the family." And so Ahab came home and pouted. The Bible said he threw a fit, and his wife came in, Jezebel, and said, "What's the matter there, big boy?" "Well," he said, "Naboth won't give me his vineyard, and I just don't think that's right, and I was going to pay him for it." She said, "Don't you worry, I'll get it for you." And what does she do? Gets him killed. She called some false witnesses in, and they ended up stoning Naboth, taking his vineyard. Well, about the time they took the vineyard, Elijah showed up. And Elijah said, "You're both going to be judged. You should never have done that." And he was. Elijah t- told them that they would reap what they had sown, and they did reap it.
Oh, yeah.
So we look here at Joram. He was King Ahaziah's brother who did not fully turn away from idolatry. He was killed by Jehu, a chariot rider. Jehu was a chariot rider. He was anointed to be the king of the prophet at Elisha's direction. Jehu executed Jezebel and the 70 kings of King Ahab, 70 sons, wiped his whole family out, made a pyramid out of their heads. And Jehu was a man of blood. And he dismantled some of the idols, but not all the idols. 2 Kings 10:31, Jehu was not careful to keep the law of the Lord, the God of Israel, with all his heart. And when we don't keep the law of God with all our hearts, we're setting ourselves up for what? Trouble. Yeah. Jehu reigned from 841 to 814. He did evil. He died of natural causes. King Jehoahaz was Jehu's son, who late in his reign cried out for God's help after Israel suffered severe oppression by the king of Syria. So these are the northern kings. We're not quite finished with them, so we're just going to kind of go back through. I know you're probably wondering, where is he? And as a matter of fact, I've got some handouts up here. We'll give you one after it's over for the north. Jehoahash was Jehoahaz's son, and he was one who practiced Baal worship, idolatry. Jehoash sought Elisha's counsel, and he prophesied that he would have 3 victories over Syria, and he did. And Elisha told him, you should have asked for more than that. He said, shoot some arrows out the window, and as many as you shoot will be how many victories you win over Syria. And he only shot 3 arrows. And Elisha said, you should have shot more than that. And 3 victories did not wipe out the armies of Syria. And so Jehoash, king of, when King Amaziah of Judah baited Jehoash into war, Jehoash sacked Jerusalem. He reigned from 798 to 782. He did evil. His death was natural causes. Jeroboam II was Jehoash's son, who restored much of the land lost during the reign of Jehoahaz. Like the kings before him, he continued worshiping these false gods. This is a ruin of Mount Gerizim where they had some of these idols and false altars to these gods of theirs. It's still there today. Nevertheless, God used the king for good. The Bible tells us the Lord had seen how bitterly everyone in Israel was suffering, since the Lord had not said he would blot out the name of Israel from under heaven. He saved them by the hand of Jeroboam. So he reigns from 793 to 753. He did evil. He died of natural causes. Zechariah was the son of Jeroboam II. And he reigned 6 months before being assassinated. Shalom assumed the throne after King Zechariah. 1 month later, Shalom was assassinated. They started killing their kings. Menahem came to the throne by killing King Shalom. He secured his position by heavily taxing his people to pay bribes to the powerful Assyrian Empire. God told him, your strength comes from the Lord. The battle is the Lord's. The battle's not the Assyrian armies.
Yes.
It's your battle, and it's my battle, God said. Pekahiah, what a name to have. Pekahiah. That was his son. He was also a wicked king, killed by Pekah, a chief official. Pekahiah was killed by Pekah. Kind of funny there, isn't it? They did evil. Like I said, all these northern kings did evil. King Pekah, established alliances with neighboring kings to try to fend off the encroaching Assyrian Empire, something condemned by the prophet Isaiah. Hosea failed to pay the tribute money to the king of Assyria, and so he marches on Samaria. He imprisoned Hosea and deported the people. This would have been 721 BC is when the north lost their power. The king of Assyria came in 721 BC, marched them slap out of the land. 70 years in, and actually more than that in the north. They stayed in Assyria and never did return. In the south, they marched to Babylon for 70 years, and that's what we're going to get to today. Now, here's some good kings. Rehoboam, after the death of his father, King Solomon, Rehoboam fought against Jeroboam of Israel and gained control of Judah in the south. King Rehoboam listened to the foolish advisors, and Judah, like Israel, fell into idolatry and immorality. Let's look at this real quick. 1 Kings chapter 11 and verse number 43. 1 Kings chapter 11, verse number 43. Tells you why that he got in trouble. 1 Kings 11, verse 43. It says, the time that Solomon reigned in Jerusalem over all Israel was 40 years. Solomon slept with his fathers and was buried in the city of David, his father, and Rehoboam, his son, reigned in his stead. Now, as I've told you before, you can remember who stayed in the south and who jumped north. Rehoboam remained in the south. Jeroboam jumped north. And he wasn't even related to Solomon. But he persuaded about 10 tribes to follow him. So you had a civil war between the 10 northern tribes and the 2 southern tribes. Then in chapter number 12, Rehoboam went to Shechem, for all Israel was come to Shechem to make him the king. So it came to pass when Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, who was yet in Egypt, heard of it, he was fled from the presence of King Solomon, that Jeroboam dwelt in Egypt, that they sent and called him. And Jeroboam and all the congregation of Israel came and spake unto Rehoboam, saying, thy father, who was Solomon, verse number 4, chapter 12 there, 1 Kings 12, 4, thy father made our yoke grievous, hard to bear. How did he do that? Well, he raised the taxes. Now therefore make thou the grievous service of your father and his heavy yoke which he put upon us lighter. Let up a little bit, and we will serve thee. Talking to Rehoboam the king. This is Solomon's son. They said, if you just let up and make the taxes, if you lower the taxes, make our living conditions a little better, we'll serve you. And he said unto them, depart yet for 3 days, and then come again to me. And the people departed. So Rehoboam says, I've got to have 3 days to study this situation. I'm going to see what I'm going to do. Now, what's he going to do? He's going to call the older men in and ask their advice. Then he's going to call the young men in and ask their advice. Let's see how this works. Verse number 6. And King Rehoboam consulted with the old men that stood before Solomon, his father, while he yet lived, and said, how do you advise that I may answer this people? And they spake unto him, saying, if thou wilt be a servant to this people. Now these are the older men. They're very wise. They've been down the road before. They're telling him, if you'll be a servant to this people, they will serve you and answer to you and speak good words to you. Then they will be thy servants forever. But he forsook the counsel of the old man. Isn't that terrible? I mean, there's something about wisdom that comes with age. The Bible even says, you know, Talk to some of the older people. Make them your counselors. They've been down the road before. They can tell you things that will help you. These men served with his daddy, and he turned his back upon them. He forsook the counsel of the old men, which they had given him, and consulted with the young men. These are his buddies. And they were grown up with him, which stood before him. And these boys were trying to get probably on his cabinet. They wanted to be his advisors. And so they tell him, you tell those people you're going to make the burden even heavier than it ever was. You're going to raise taxes even more. And that's what he goes with. Look at verse number 9. And he said unto them, what counsel give ye that we may answer this people who have spoken unto me, saying, make the yoke which thy father did put upon us lighter? And the young men that were grown up with him spake unto him, saying, thus shalt thou speak unto this people that spake unto thee, saying, thy father made our yoke heavy, make thou it lighter unto us. Thus shalt thou say unto them, my little finger shall be thicker than my father's loins.
Yeah.
Sounds to me like he's getting ready to declare war on his own people. I mean, my little finger's going to be thicker than what daddy's loins were. Verse number 11, and now whereas my father did lay you with a heavy yoke, I will add to your yoke. My father was chasing you with whips. I'll chastise you with scorpions. That doesn't sound too appealing, does it?
Not really.
How many people you think would want to be a servant to a king like that? Turn the scorpions loose on you. Raise your taxes. We've already seen some of that. And that always hurts. And so verse number 12, Jeroboam and all the people came to Rehoboam the third day, just like they planned it, saying, come to me again the third day. And the king answered the people roughly, and he forsook the old men's counsel that they gave him. What did the old men tell him to do? Work with the people. Serve the people. Love the people. And they'll do the same for you. What you sow, you reap. But if you tell them you're going to make the taxes heavier and you're going to make their burden a whole lot worse, then they're going to turn on you. But he didn't believe the old men. So he spake to them after the counsel of the young men in verse 14, saying, my father made your yoke heavy, and I will add to your yoke. My father also chastened you with whips, but I'm going to chastise you with scorpions. Wherefore the king hearkened not unto the people, for the cause was from the Lord, that he might perform his saying which he spake by Ahijah the Shilonite unto Jeroboam the son of Nebat. And so all Israel saw the king hearkened not unto them. People answered the king, saying, what portion have we with David? Neither have we inheritance with the son of David. To your tents, O Israel. They're upset. Go to your tent. We're not serving this guy. He's crazy. Now see to thine own house, David. So Israel, the northern 10 tribes, went to their tents. And as for the children of Israel which dwelt in the cities of Judah, they stayed with Rehoboam. The king Rehoboam sent Adoram, which was over the tribute or the tax collector, and all Israel stoned him with stones. How'd you like to stone the tax collector? You may not do it, but you might think, well, I wish he'd light up a little bit, huh?
You think about it.
You think about it, wouldn't you? Well, they did. He sent that tax collector out to get the money, and he got killed. He died. Therefore, King Rehoboam made speed to get up to his chariot and flee to Jerusalem. He left there like a whipped puppy dog. So Israel rebelled against the house of David unto this day, and it came to pass, when all Israel heard that Jeroboam was come again, they sent and called him unto the congregation, and they made him the king over all of Israel. Now that's the northern 10 tribes, the ones we've studied. They're all bad kings. That there was none that followed the house of David but the tribe of Judah. So Rehoboam, in his great plan to raise taxes and to make the load heavier, ends up with just one tribe here. Actually, there was two tribes altogether. And 10 tribes left him. They left him. And when Rehoboam was come to Jerusalem, he assembled all the house of Judah and the tribe of Benjamin, 84,000 chosen men, which were warriors, to fight against the house of Israel. He's going to try to bring the kingdom back to him through a war. Now he has Judah and he has Benjamin. Those are the two tribes that stayed with him. That's what you see in verse number 21. But the word of God came unto Shemaiah, the man of God, saying, you better speak to Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, king of Judah, and unto all the house of Judah and Benjamin, and to the remnant of this people, saying, thus saith the Lord, ye shall not go up nor fight against your brethren, the children of Israel. Don't you go up there and fight them. See, he's trying to take 180,000 warriors, go north and conquer the northern 10 tribes, bring them back in with the southern 2 tribes. But God says, don't do it. Don't do it lest you get hurt. Return every man to his house, for this thing is from me. God's the one that was in charge of it. They hearkened therefore to the word of the Lord, and returned to depart according to the word of the Lord. So we see here that this Rehoboam made a terrible mistake when he forsook the counsel of the old men. There's something about that that tells us, listen to your superiors. Listen to those who are over you. Listen to those who are older than you. And you don't have to always do what they say, but it doesn't hurt to get their advice. That's for sure. Look with me at chapter 14 now, verse 21 through 31. The reign of Rehoboam. This is Solomon's son. He has 2 tribes, Benjamin and Judah. And Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, reigned in Judah. Rehoboam was 41 years old when he began to reign. And he reigned 17 years in Jerusalem, the city which the Lord did choose out of all the tribes of Israel to put his name there. His mother's name was Naamah, the Ammonitess. And the Ammonites were enemies of the Israelites. And so this tells me that Solomon actually had wives of some of his enemies. An Ammonite. That would be one of Solomon's wives of Rehoboam. So verse 22 there, chapter 14. Judah did evil in the sight of the Lord. They provoked him to jealousy with their sins that they committed above all their fathers had done. They built high places, images, groves, and on every high hill and under every green tree. They would put these images of Baal on these altars and worship. These are people in the south. They're supposed to be the ones still loyal to the Lord. And they turned on God. Not only that, but notice what else. And there was also Sodomites in the land. Verse 24. They did according to all the abomination of the nations that the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. So it came to pass in the 5th year of King Rehoboam that Shishak, the king of Egypt, came up against Jerusalem, took away all the treasures of the house of the Lord. That's why some people believe that they lost the Ark of the Covenant to the Egyptians. Because this man here was an Egyptian leader who had an army, and he invaded the southern 2 tribes and took the furniture out of the temple. Now what he had with him, we don't know. But some people want to make a case that he had the Ark of the Covenant. So they took the treasures of the house of the Lord in verse 26, the treasures of the king's house. He lived in a different place. He took away all, and he took away all the shields of gold which Solomon had made, and King Rehoboam made in their stead brazen shields. Now brazen is nothing like gold. It's brass. But he did make some shields and stuck them back in there. And so, verse number 28, and it was so when the king went into the house of the Lord that the guard bare them and brought them back into the guard chamber. Now the rest of the acts of Rehoboam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? And there was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam all their days. Remember, Jeroboam's over the north. He jumps north. Rehoboam remains in the south. And they fought back and forth, civil war, all their lives. And Rehoboam slept with his fathers and was buried with his fathers in the city of David. His mother's name was Naamah the Ammonitess, and Abijah his son reigned in his stead. So, was this a good king or a bad king? He's a bad king. He's an evil king. Now you see on your handout, the next one down is Abijah, that's his son. He reigns from 913 to 911. 2 years. He dies of natural causes. He did evil. Okay. Let me move our... Well, let's go ahead and read this. After the death of his father, King Solomon, Rehoboam fought against Jeroboam of Israel, gained control of Judah in the south. King Rehoboam listened to the foolish advisors, and Judah, like Israel, and fell into idolatry and immorality. Abijah, like his father Rehoboam, King Abijah, battled against Jeroboam in the north. And he also worshiped these idols. So that's what they're doing. They're idol worshipers. 1 Kings chapter 14, verse 31. We just read that one. But chapter 15, notice with me if you will, in verse number 1. And then the 18th year of King Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, reigned Abijam over Judah. 3 years reigned he in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishon, and he walked in all the sins of his father which he had done before him. So he does just as wicked as his daddy did, Rehoboam. Now one thing you can say about Rehoboam, he didn't have 1,000 wives like his daddy did. King Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. And that's just substitutes. He had 1,000. 999, too many there, son. Got you in some big trouble. But Abijah, what about this man? Well, he walked in all the sins of his father, which he had done before him in verse number 3, chapter 15. His heart was not perfect with the Lord his God, as the heart of David was. Nevertheless, for David's sake, did the Lord his God give him a lamp in Jerusalem to set up his son after him and to establish Jerusalem. Because David did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord. Now, did David always do right in the eyes of the Lord? No. But he could repent as much as he could sin. I mean, he committed a great sin. But he really repented and wept and asked God for forgiveness, and God forgave him. If we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to what? Forgive us of our sin. And so David is known after a man who had the heart of God. David. And so because of King David, Abijah is being blessed. David would have been his grandfather. He turned not aside from anything that he commanded him all the days of his life, save in the matter of Uriah the Hittite. There was war, verse number 6, chapter 15. There was war between Rehoboam and Jeroboam all the days of his life. Now the rest of the acts of Abijam and all that he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles of the kings of Judah? There was war between Abijah and Jeroboam. And Abijah slept with his fathers, and they buried him in the city of David. And Asa, his son, reigned in his stead. Well, let's see if Asa did right. Look on your handout, third down from the top. He reigns from 911 to 870. That's about 41 years. He had a severe foot disease, but he did right. And God blessed him. And so you see this in chapter number 15. Let me move it up just a little bit here. Asa. King Asa was Abijah's son. He drove out all the idol worshipers from the land, including his wicked and powerful grandmother. That would have been a wife of Solomon. And he drove her out because she was one of those that tried to get Solomon to worship the idols. He fought the Cushites and made a treaty with Aram of Syria to fend off King Baasha of Israel. His death was because of that foot disease. Notice what it says in verse number 9. 1 Kings chapter 15, verse number 9. And in the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah. Now Jeroboam's been through about three or four kings here. But his day's coming, as we'll see shortly. Jeroboam's in the north. He jumped north. Rehoboam remained in the south. And this would be Rehoboam's grandson, Asa. 41 years reigned he in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Maacah, the daughter of Abishalom. And Asa did that which was right. Amen. Glory to God. Finally, somebody did the right thing. He did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord, as did David his father. Isn't that great? Finally, we see somebody that has some sins.
Who do you think was the best? David.
David would be the best king of all. Yeah, King David was the best.
I mean, it's left.
Yeah. But this man here was a good king. Asa. He took away the Sodomites out of the land, verse number 12, removed all the idols that his father